Hey, how's it going, guys? I'm Paradoxic, and welcome back to Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Last time, we met the Watchdogs. The online hate group turned weaponized army of, racists, pretty much. And they were hunting down Inhumans. They're hunting down humans. That's what their whole thing is. They round up Inhumans and they try and do bad things to them, and they're very, very prejudiced towards them. So we met them at the Watchdogs, and we saw kind of different kind of, approaches to dealing with them. I mean, I say different approaches, but like we saw how Mac was being hunted by them because they thought he had the powers that Daisy has, because she used them in front of him, and perspective wise it lined up with his hands and stuff like that. So we had that. They're led by Felix Blake. Felix Blake returned from way back when, the guy who had his back broken by Deathlok. He got out of hospital, then discovered the whole S.H.I.E.L.D. versus Hydra thing going on, and then he came up with the Watchdogs and blamed, S.H.I.E.L.D. and the Avengers for all the stuff that happened with aliens ever since then. So he's leading the Watchdogs. I don't think he actually came up with the Watchdogs, but he did actually lead them. Like once he got released from the hospital and he found out everything that was going on, because I think the team did say that the Watchdogs were like created in the wake of New York and the alien stuff that happened in New York, and they were more and more anxious after each attack and each kind of movie disaster that happened. So I think it was after he left and he found the Watchdogs, and then he actually made himself the leader and whatnot. So yeah, but we saw him return. He had holograms to make it look like he could walk out and about, but he actually still needed a wheelchair. So he's in cahoots with Malik and Guerra and them lot, and they stole him a giant rocket from a former ATCU branch of some kind, like a facility that the Watchdogs then shrunk with nitramine. We saw nitramine playing a role in the last episode. So that was all of that stuff. And Lincoln, he had his first field mission. Lincoln had his first field mission with Coulson. He, Coulson got his report, his evaluation from, not the caterpillar. What is it called? I was about to call it the caterpillar. It's not the caterpillar. The cocoon. The thing that caterpillar comes out of as a beautiful butterfly. No, the cocoon. He got his evaluation from there. But then, Coulson being Coulson, he needed first-hand visual proof that Lincoln had what it takes to be a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. He had commitment and focus and sheer fucking will and everything. So he took him out in the field on his own, and they went up against Blake, and then he gave him the orders to kill Blake because he knew Blake wasn't really there, it was a hologram. All that stuff went down, but overall Lincoln impressed him, so that was cool to see. But yeah, we saw that. We met Mac's brother, Ruben, who Daisy so eloquently dubbed as Mini-Mac. But Mac, Mini-Mac was one of those people who was actually swept up in the Watchdogs kind of, propaganda, pretty much. People with troubles are looking for someone to blame, looking for answers, looking for a place to, see that kind of stuff going down. So then he ever so slightly agreed with the stuff that they were saying, because they were saying we need answers, we need to be kept safe. It wasn't so explicit as to go like, oh, these people are dangerous, we need to wipe them out, genocide is the only answer. It was never anything explicit as that, but it was like more of a case of actually goading the public in with seemingly helpful and seemingly hopeful kind of speech and messages and stuff. So Ruben fell in with that kind of line of thinking, but then in the end him and Mac did end up actually having to fight their way out of their own house, which the Watchdogs had invaded and stuff. So yeah, we met Ruben. It was a fun episode, and we got to see some cool Easter eggs here and there, and it was a good kind of continuation. I think it was actually cool to actually finally see that the Watchdogs weren't like just an online thing, because I think that is what Daisy mentioned them to be first off, that they were just some kind of online hate group targeting Inhumans and stuff. So yeah, it's scary to see them being like an actual weaponized group of terrorists and whatnot, but it's the way things went down. So I'm curious to see if they actually play a bigger role going forward, because I think Felix is still alive, and he also has his own bigger rocket now, so what he's going to use that for, we don't know yet, and we don't even know, like, what kind of rocket, if it's, like, a full-on nuke, or if it's, like, something else that could do, like, city-wide damage or something, but I don't know. But, I mean, with the Watch Dogs, it is, like, their kind of main aim right now is to, you know, like, they keep going on about rounding up the freaks and taking them all out, so with a rocket, that would be terrifyingly easy. It would be terrifyingly easy. So I guess we have to wait and see. But that is pretty much all I've got from the last one. So on to episode 15. This is the highlight reel, not the full length. This is the highlight reel. So if you guys want to watch the full length, all you need is your own copy of the episode, and you can sync it up, and it'll be good to go. That will be over on Patreon, so you can go check that out over there. But yeah, so on to episode 15 of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Let's go.
Oh! Oh, he's inhuman.
Help! Save me, please! So sorry.
What?
We're running out of time, Daisy. This is where I die.
Daisy?
Okay, that happened.
That's what she'll yell when they come out of the sky.
She? Out of the sky? Oh, the drones! Drones! Oh crap, is this some Hydra 6? Oh no, it's not a drone, it's a full-on chopper, I was wrong. Oh, it's an attack chopper, Jesus. Oh, the claw, the frickin' Toy Story claw, oh damn. Fitzsimmons. Lincoln? Oh, baby boy, Lincoln. Oh. Coulson, shots fired. Damn, they finally have a clairvoyant inhuman. Oh, damn. Okay, a long coat ward now. Long coat Hydra ward, looking like Neo out of the Matrix.
He is risen. What an improvement.
Yeah, looking like Neo out of the Matrix.
Like, an extra from Dawn of the Dead, and now.
That's a lovely red dress.
Thank you.
That's a lovely blue one, too.
If you saw the future, then that's the future.
Fitz would make an efficient Time Lord.
I can't explain how it felt, but...
We flat paper people perceive this three-dimensional cube as many separate two-dimensional moments. As time passing, the point on the line traveling through space and time. It just is, and nothing you can do will change that.
You're hurting my brain.
Mine Look, too. I'm not sure I fully get that,
if
but it's kind
right
of.
Or if I even understand what he's saying, really.
Yeah.
But Hydra has this guy, and we gotta try to.
I mean, it's already created. Like your. I mean, your decisions and actions can influence it still, but other than that, you can't really do much.
Not let Daisy out of the base.
So don't be anywhere that your future selves were in that vision. You should be fine. So that kind of stuff is actually your choices and actions influencing the thing.
To save his mom, to make sure he's born. Doesn't that mean he doesn't have to?
I never saw the original Terminator.
You're off the team.
What's tripping me out is that we only knew to try.
Neither
have
I, to be honest.
He heard Daisy's name.
Charles carved a little bird. I think it was a robin out of wood.
He did?
Oh, is it sentimental value?
That's his father's name. Robin.
Oh, Robin.
Charles left in the night, and he left because he would never be able to hold his little girl again. At least not without her crying and screaming.
Oh, yeah, that would traumatize a kid. That would traumatize a kid very, very easily.
This state-of-the-art prosthetic contains some hardware.
That's Stein. That's Stein from Supernatural, the leader of the Steins.
Yeah. To be precise.
And he said to buy a body part. That makes sense.
I said I would show you what will happen.
Oh, what will happen regardless? Oh, that is evil. That is evil. Yeah. Jeez. Inhumans. What would that do for him, though? What is it like? It's like an exosuit, yeah. Yeah, but what kind of exosuit is it? Is it like actually give him extra strength and stuff?
Shoot
okay. Okay, bang down. Bang! Oscar for Fitz. Oscar goes to Fitz. Bang! This is basically how they fight, though. They can't actually fight for a TV show. Yeah, this is basically how the stunts go. Yeah. There we go. Yeah, that's basically how they do the stunts. Like, you know, no contact, just, you know, bang, bang, pow, stuff. Can you break that vase? You can break that vase. You can break that vase.
But to drain a man's life with your own.
Yeah, it's the emotional power behind it.
Life go out inside him.
The psychopath is still there. The psychopath is still inside. Ward might be dead, but
did with me.
Yeah. The psychopath is still inside. Oh damn. Oh. Oh, his head is gonna be gone. Oh,
ready when you are.
I remember doing that as a kid. When you actually play cops and robbers with as a kid, you just, you know, pretend your hands are your guns.
Intruder.
Intruder alert. Where are they coming from? Who is the intruder? Andrew.
About to turn for the last time, mate.
Oh damn! He's close to the end of his transition.
Say goodbye.
He's close to the end of his transition. Oh, okay.
If it goes south, get out. Don't try to be a hero. And for God's sakes, Guy, come home.
It's Daisy, sir.
Damn it. Daisy. Right, Daisy. Just.
I'm sorry.
Come home safe.
How could that slip out? You managed to call her Daisy this entire time, and all of a sudden it's Sky again. I mean, I guess he must revert back. I don't know, maybe through parental instinct or something? Maybe, I don't know.
In S.H.I.E.L.D.'s hands, because despite knowing my actions were wrong, I still feel that I was doing it all for an important reason.
That's the monster talking again.
Maybe. But I feel like he's fighting for a cause we don't understand yet. And I don't know.
Yeah, the more inhumans he takes out,
might need him.
The less the Hydra creature has. Yeah, he could be the key to defeating Ward. Yeah.
Also, could be you all are crazy and this is pointless and nothing we see here will make any sense.
Oh, Jesus. Yep, that was Ward, guys. That was Ward.
Was that Ward?
Yeah, huh?
Unfortunately, I think that's something else.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no, Fitz would know. Fitz would know.
What is she walking into?
Yeah. Boom, 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 pow, kapow, kapoosh, there we go. Bang, bang. Yep, alarm. Oh, come on. Yep, or she just uses her powers, yeah. He's not shooting you, he's shooting the mirror. Yeah, he's shooting the mirror.
We don't go any closer, we stay here.
Yeah.
That cloud in the sky.
Well, I mean, you're in front of the sun. You're
maybe
in front
Daisy
of the trees.
See the future.
No, you're in front of trees. I'm pretty sure. So stay away from trees, too. You know, Charles. Oh. Oh. Oh, it's Malik. It's Gideon Malik with his exosuit. It's not snow. It's ash.
What if the death Daisy saw was her own?
It's not snow falling. It's ash from the fire.
All units, stop. Do not pursue.
Oh,
Lincoln, geez. Where are you?
I have eyes on Ward.
Andrew's gone.
But you were meant to save me.
Finally. Made a difference.
I think we're supposed to hold hands now.
I don't get it. There was never anything bad about their vision. Like, some of the stuff she saw was scary, but this was never. Nothing seems
inevitable.
Worrisome about this.
So she will always need protection. I was hoping you could help.
Find Robin and take her in, or. Yeah, just give her some kind of shield protection. R.I.P. Cha. Whoa. Oh, yeah, the rocket. There's the spaceship in space that explodes. And there's like an SSR patch on someone's shoulder. Yeah, now she sees it. First we saw it, now she sees it. Crucifix, box, SSR patch. Yeah. Yeah, no, so this episode took a... I think this episode took what I found to be a clever way, like a clever look into clairvoyancy. And I think it like the way it worked, like, you know, being able to see into the future, you know, foreshadowing events before they happen and all the stuff leading up to, like the way it kind of described it, I just couldn't help but look back into what, like, you know, like what this show's original kind of interpretation of clairvoyancy was back in season one with the literal clairvoyant and everything. Well, not literal, but with the clairvoyant. But yeah, no, like it, I mean, well, with that one, it was a mixture of using of past and future events kind of being foretold, and or past events being told and future events being foretold. But you know, with this one, this was an actual inhuman clairvoyant who could touch people and even project that sense of the future into their own minds. So yeah, so that was Charles Hinton. He was an inhuman. I think I kind of mentioned, okay, so he probably had fish at some point, and then that, like, he gained inhuman powers from that, but they didn't specifically mention it. But at the same time, it's like, at this point, you don't really need to mention each time that they consumed fish in some way, because we now know that's what it is. Like, you know, if humans consume it, then nothing happens, but then if inhumans consume it, then the fish actually does something to them. So they didn't need to reference every time. But then his wife found him in, like, a inhuman husk thing, and then when she touched him, she had the future projected into her head and stuff. And even when they were walking back into the house, she touched him again. So it is skin-on-skin contact. So then, I don't know why he would wear fingerless gloves then. I mean, he's... I was pretty sure I could see his fingers in the beginning of the episode, and that's why I was wondering, like, you know, why doesn't he wear gloves then? But he turns out he is, just has the top of the fingers chopped off and everything. So I don't know why that would be, like, you know... you know, like, wear, like, go rogue style, just go wear like full-on gloves, and that way you don't actually risk, you know, even being able to touch somebody in the slightest. But yeah, I don't know why he wore fingerless gloves, but for some reason he did. But yeah, no, so he touched the Edwin Abbott dude, the grocery shop runner in the beginning, and he transferred Daisy's name and the shield and Hydra stuff. So I think that was cool. Seeing how it went down, that was cool. Like, they got to the scene, and then he even recognized Daisy, and then he saw everything unfolding as it was meant to. And then he said, you know, oh, the lady's gonna scream Hydra as they come out of the sky, and that sounded ominous. But then you realize, you know, it's just like one of their attack helicopters coming down, firing rockets, and then May screaming Hydra, she pulls out a gun. So that kind of stuff was cool to see unfold. And I think those kinds of things, I think those kinds of stories, those kinds of, like, in, like, episodal concepts are really cool to see explored. Like, in, like, you start off with, like, you know, I think it's two of my favorite type of, like, foreshadowing, like, concept in terms of actually being able to see the future. Like, you either get like a hint of what's about to come in the beginning, and then it cuts back and says, you know, oh, 24 hours earlier or something like that. Sometimes it annoys me, sometimes I actually enjoy it, because like, I hate being teased like that, and then they actually go back to the beginning and show me something completely different. But then, you know, it's actually leading up to whatever it is. Or you get stuff like this where they show you glimpses of the future from someone else's kind of perspective and everything, and then, yeah, that stuff happens, and then you actually see it unfold as it goes along. So yes, I mean, the way they explored it in this was really great. And I think especially I liked Fitz's explanation of it, but at the same time, it kind of confused me too, the way he used, like, you know, like, he explained it with, like, 2D and 3D, and, you know, using, like drawing a diagonal, like a line down paper, and saying, you know, like, flipping it up and saying, like, you know, it's like a fixed point. It's like, in, like you see it as a kind of 3D thing, but it's actually not. It's just like a line, and, you know, you can't really change it. It's already, like, you know, fixed in time. And he would make a great Time Lord. I said it then, I'll say it again. He would make a great Time Lord. He would be the one to just tell everyone, like, you know, no, you cannot change this. It's a fixed point in time. You can't go around saving people and stuff, you know. So him and Simmons would have made a... I mean, Simmons alone would make a great companion, but Fitz alone, he would, you know, be siding with the Doctor whenever it came to, you know, arguing against messing up fixed points in time. But then if he goes into the TARDIS and then he discovers time travel, then I think his mind would be blown. So yeah, his explanation. I didn't fully understand it, but I mean time itself, like, I think the way he said you can't really change it, I agree with that to an extent, because I think you know, once you, like, without seeing it, you don't know how time might unfold. You can, like, kind of predict what the based on various factors, you can predict what the outcome might be, and you can even change that. Your actions can influence it, but you, like, you know, without actually having seen the future, without seeing the future the way you saw it here, you wouldn't really know what would happen. You know, you hope for the best and you work with what you got to make what you want to happen, but you can't control it fully. But then when you actually see the future, I think it's that's when you fall into this kind of situation where you actually try and, you know, like, kind of mold each and every little snippet vision to, you know, work out to your advantage and everything. Like, you know, her actually, you know, like Daisy running that simulation of the fight in the office through, like, a bunch of different times and making sure she could actually catch up to and stuff. So yeah, I mean time is a, to not to quote the Doctor too much, but it's a wibbly wobbly ball of timey-wimey stuff. So yeah, I think that's the best way I can understand it for now. Like, you know, like even when you see it, you like, that's the only way you can probably try and change what happened, because then you know what is most likely to happen in the future. But then even in this, like, Daisy misinterpreted a lot of what was happening. Like, you know, she thought she saw Coulson shooting at her, but Coulson was shooting at her reflection because he knew it was, like, a one-way mirror, so he was shooting the guy on the other side, so it wasn't actually her. And then even Charles, like, you know, she thought Charles was actually, she thought she was meant to save Charles when he was lying down on the floor, but then he was only lying down on the floor because he was saving her from Malik. So yeah, and then even the Fitzsimmons stuff, like, you know, like them standing in front of a tree and then it seemed like there was snow falling down. Like, I mean, some of the stuff she saw didn't really seem too worrisome, like the stuff like Coulson shooting and Charles on the ground and Lincoln on the ground with his face covered in blood because the fire extinguisher and stuff like that. Kind of stuff definitely raised, like, some cause for concern. But then the Fitzsimmons stuff didn't really seem all that worse. Like they were just standing in front of a tree and it seemed to be snowing. So I mean, obviously the way she took it was that, you know, each of those visions is connected in some way. They all lead up to one single outcome. It all kind of adds up and, you know, leads to something. So changing those visions is what matters. So that, I think, yeah, I mean, you can't really blame her about that. I think another factor could have been the fact that, you know, she kind of interpreted it to be immediately kind of disastrous or dangerous. Because again, like, why would Coulson shoot her? Why would Coulson actually shoot her? Because, like, even if she was possessed, I don't really think he would shoot her unless he knew that he had, like, non-lethal bullets, like an ice or something. But I think the gun he had in that vision was not an ice. It had like a yellowy kind of bang, like a regular gun would. So yeah, I don't know, but it was a cool way to execute that kind of space-time kind of concept, anyway. And also, Charles showed her the vision of the spaceship in space getting blown up, the one with the crucifix and the blood and the loot crate-style crate, and also the person with the SSR patch, the eagle patch on their shoulder, so we have yet to see exactly what that's all about. I can't really even guess like a context for that, because I think they haven't gone into space like the majority of their stuff. I mean, they haven't gone into space, but they have gone to another planet through a wormhole through space. They've gone to Marvet, so that's like the closest they've come to actually going to space, like to going, you know, to another planet. But yeah, in terms of actually going into space, like into the stars through a spaceship and being in Earth's orbit, that kind of stuff they haven't achieved yet. So I think it would probably take considerably less of a budget to actually show that kind of vision than it would to actually have to put the actors in like that kind of environment, to actually put them in a fully CGI'd room. But I mean, they did that for Marvel. They actually filmed that somewhere on Earth and then CGI'd some planets and moons and shit in the background. But Yeah, but I mean, yeah, I mean, I can't really guess what the context for that one might be, because I think it's a very, very kind of minimalistic kind of vision. Like, even as a vision, it's very minimalistic. It doesn't really show much. Shows some stuff hovering, and shows a spaceship hovering through space, and then shows a person wearing an eagle jacket, like an eagle patch on the jacket, and then all of a sudden there's an explosion. So there's not really a huge amount of context for what that could be, or like, what could lead to it. But now Daisy knows that that's the next thing coming in. The next disaster coming in, so she needs to work out what that's all about. And because I mean, for all they know, they could be sending someone else into space to kill them, or you know, kill it, or like it could be something that actually needs to happen if they want to win. But we don't know. We do not know. But yeah, it was a fun concept to explore. Spacetime, fun concept. It was also fun to see the team discovering that Ward was still alive. To see Ward, I think it was a cool way they executed that reveal too. Like, it's not like he actually stares into the camera and smiles for a few seconds. It's like he turns around, they hear Stacy's face for like 2 seconds max, and then the feed shuts off. But it's like long enough for them to actually see his face and to, you know, register that it is in fact the body of Grant Ward, even if it's not. I love that Fitz at least clocked that, you know, that's something else, because you know, Coulson remembers having killed him, but you know, doesn't remember having seen the other creature. But Fitz is the one who actually killed the creature inside Will and put it to rest permanently using the flare gun. So he knows that, you know, Ward was killed. He knows Ward was killed by Coulson. So like, you know, and you know, Will, he knows Will died protecting Gemma from the Hydra creature. So then the only reason that, you know, he was able to walk again when they went back was because the Hydra creature was inside him. So the only logical conclusion then is that, you know, the Hydra creature left Will's carcass and then jumped right into Will, into Fitz, the Ward's body even. So he knows, you know, whatever that is, it's no longer Grant Ward. It's something much, much worse. So yeah, they're seeing the team's reaction to seeing Ward's face again was really, really cool. I've been wondering when that might come up, like, because I've been wondering if it's going to be something like a scene like this, or if it might be a scene where like they actually come face to face while hunting down Gideon and Giera and whatnot. So yeah, to see this, like, this is far more ominous. Like, they're not actually face to face just yet, but now they actually get some kind of visual confirmation that Ward's body is has been reanimated and whatnot. So yeah, but Ward himself, he had a plan. He wanted to give Gideon Malik, you know, true power, and it wasn't anything to do. Turns out, it was less to do with superpowers or inhuman powers or, you know, any kind of, you know, powered exoskeletons that he gave. Like, the exoskeleton was a, you know, nifty upgrade, but The true power came from Gideon having the power to actually kill someone with his own bare hand. And even the way this Ward described it, like, you know, you've had other people killed for you, you've ordered their deaths, you've, you know, even considered shooting someone yourself, but you never actually killed someone with your bare hands. You've never actually gone down that dark tunnel before. So he gave him the extra added power to be able to crush someone's head, and he did. He crushed the guy's. I mean, we didn't see the full, you know, the full extent of it. We saw his head kind of being rectangularized, but, or like, you know, pancaked pretty much. But you know, they didn't go too graphic. I was surprised by how far they went, but they didn't go too graphic. But yeah, I think that kind of surprised me, because, like, I mean, yeah, like Ward, because like the creature has no voice or, you know, kind of personification of its own. It has no, like, it needs a vessel to survive. It needs a vessel to do what it does. So it still walks in Ward's body. It still uses his voice. But it is the brain. It is the CPU inside Ward's body. It is the one doing all the controlling. So Ward himself is dead. Ward's brain is gone. Ward's heart is gone. Anything that was Ward was gone. But his body is still being used to help personify this creature. And I think, and it still holds memories. It still holds memories of what Ward used to be. It's still kind of, I think it hasn't like destroyed his brain, but it's kind of engulfed his brain and is using it to kind of power itself too. So it has access to Ward's memories and stuff, and it remembers being killed by Phil Coulson. And like the way he described it, like that's why he kept the hand. The hand was something Coulson used to actually kill Ward. And then he left that behind because it was like, you know, he killed someone with his bare hands out of anger, out of vengeance, and to finally end all these, like, you know, years long kind of feud between them. So, you know, like, yeah, so like the way he described that kind of, you know, and like, even the way he encouraged Gideon himself to actually kill the other guy with his bare hands was like, you know, okay, so like the psychopathy, the psychopath in him has been retained somewhat, like that kind of mentality has been retained because, you know, Ward had killed with his bare hands. He'd snapped necks and punched faces and all sorts of other stuff before, so the Hydra creature had retained that kind of mentality and used that to actually convince Gideon to actually do some killing of his own. So, yeah, that was ominous. It was ominous. And Malik pointed out at the dinner table that his ancestry actually believed in Hydra. So that's kind of that's intriguing to me. Like, you know, he said his ancestors actually believed in this Hydra creature and believed in bringing it back to Earth. So I mean, yeah, I mean, it's not the first time he's mentioned that, you know, he himself has dedicated his entire life to engineering this thing's return, and his side of the family, his ancestry actually comes from the much much deeper side of Hydra that is like more cult like than, you know, like compared to the Red Skull's iteration of Hydra. But I mean, I think both sides had still had that thing where they kind of believed in true power, like, you know, like Red Skull had the ideology that, you know, true power existed, but it just couldn't be found on Earth, like Earth was too simplistic and too, you know, like narrow to actually contain that kind of power. So that's why he wanted the Tesseract, like the Space Stone, like, you know, the jewel of Odin's treasure room and everything. So, you know, so that was cool. But then, you know, like Malik believing in true power, like, you know, true power, like being, I think. Yeah, I mean, he wanted true power, like, you know, to bring back the Inhuman and have it lead its army of Inhumans on Earth where it rightfully belonged. But then the Inhuman himself kind of analyzes Gideon and just kind of sees that, you know, the true power for him would actually be killing someone with his bare hands and having that kind of power, like instead of ordering people around and building armies and stuff, like, you know, he needs to actually, you know, feel what it's like to kill someone in a genuinely psychopathic way, like doing it slowly and, you know, like describing it in such a way. So, yeah, so Gideon's, I mean, we know his daughter wasn't there. We haven't seen his daughter since after that other scene. But his daughter also kind of is also presumably a part of that same Hydra, and she knows about all that's going on. So I'm curious as to what her role in all this might be, like how kind of invested in all this she might be, if she has something going on behind the scenes or what's going to happen. But I look forward to seeing her again. And then, yeah, Andrew returned. Andrew Garner returned, and he returned as in his final form as Andrew. It was the last time he would actually be able to stay as Andrew before the transformation kicked in, and the cure didn't work. He was too far gone, so I think the cure not working on him made more sense because, again, he was too far gone, and especially since, you know, like, there's a much bigger time difference between when they actually first suggested the cure for him and to when they actually used it on him. Like they weren't able to use it on him as soon as they actually thought of the idea. So, like, a lot more time had passed, more of the Inhuman side of him had taken over the human side of him. So, like, you know, it was like their fighting chance got smaller and smaller each day and stuff. So it kind of makes sense that it wouldn't really work on him, but we still got like one final good episode to get Andrew, and they actually gave it they actually had the decency to give it to us between Andrew and May having one final day together before he finally kind of gave in to the Lash side of him. So yeah, and I think, yeah, like Andrew, even the way he described, like, you know, like Andrew, like, you know, like Lash not just being a killer but also being an Inhuman with a very specific mission, and the fact that, you know, he might even be able to help with all of this, and I think he might be true. Like, you know, Lash's thing is actually killing Inhumans because he believes that they're too dangerous, or that because he believes that they're like a threat. So he's not technically wrong, because the Inhumans, like, right now, the Inhumans of Earth right now are being collected by Gideon Malik, and they're being used to build an army. So I think Lash could be the key to then defeating Ward. Like, he takes out more Inhumans, or at least, you know, he kills the ultimate Inhuman. Like the thing inside Ward is the ultimate Inhuman creature. It's the ancient Inhuman, the one that was banished away to begin with. So, you know, send Lash against, like, to send Lash up against that thing. I mean, I don't know if he would still survive, because I think, yeah, no, the inhuman thing, it can't consume other inhumans. It cannot consume other inhumans, so he wouldn't be able to consume or kill Lash. I mean, he wouldn't be able to kill, to consume him, but he might still be able to kill him. So yeah, so because he, like, when he kills people, he usually consumes them. He usually spreads his skin cells and other cells to other people's bodies, and then that consumes them, and then that gives him more, you know, more like nourishment of his own. So but yeah, it might be good then that, you know, Lash is now the permanent form of Andrew, because now he's permanently inhuman and he can be used, like, you know, just set him on Lash. And oh, okay, I sense that might be the fight scene, the final fight scene coming up in this season. It might then be the SHIELD team trying to get through to Lash and convince him that, you know, that they have a common enemy, which is the New Ward. And also maybe the Inhumans, I think, you know, I mean, because they are kidnapping Inhumans, but none of that, but I think very few of them might be actually I think it might just be very few of them who are actually willing to fight for Warden and willing to be a part of his army. The other ones might just be kidnapped because they're Inhumans, because they happen to have powers and they're just otherwise innocent people. So we don't know how effective or how large this army of his might be, but they are superpowered people, so they can still be powerful for him. I think that might be the way they go down. So like Lash teams up with Daisy and Lincoln and Joey and stuff, and then they all kind of work together to take down Ward. That would be cool. And again, I think it kind of gives them the upper hand that they can't be consumed by him, but we've yet to see if he actually has, like, another method of killing, because so far we've only seen him consume regular humans. We haven't seen him try and kill other humans, and he hasn't because he needs inhumans. He needs inhumans to actually build his army. So then, yeah, that makes me wonder how he would react if inhumans, his own people, fought back against him, and how he would react in that situation. Okay, I can see where that's coming from. So I think, yeah, so I mean, see, so yeah, like, I think it's kind of that kind of thing, like Lash versus Ward is more of like a speculative thing for us as the audience to come up with, but I think this final episode was kind of prioritized as a goodbye to Andrew Garner. Andrew has been amazing to watch. I think it was prioritized as a goodbye to Andrew from us, but more importantly from May, like one last chance for May to actually reconcile things with Andrew and to talk to Andrew before he fully transformed and stuff. So it was good that we got that, at least. It was good that we got that. And yeah, Blair Underwood has been amazing. He's done an amazing job as both Lash and Andrew. But, you know, seeing him as Andrew, seeing the man he was, seeing the man that May married, and seeing that relationship kind of re-blossom between them, because I think we met them, you know, post-divorce, like when they were still kind of working colleagues, but after they were divorced. So seeing that side of them was a very, very good thing to see, and to see it kind of re-blossom between them was cool. And now, and then turning him into Lash was a cool twist that I never would have sort of seen coming. So it's been cool. It's been cool seeing him, and the actor, again, he's done an incredible job. So just hats off to Blair Underwood. But I can't wait to see what Lash does now. I can't wait to see what the writers do with Lash, how they utilize him in this season, and see how long he lasts too. But yeah, that is Lash. That is Lash. But yeah, that is pretty much all I've got from this episode too. So it was a fun one. Looking forward to seeing how all of this adds up and where we go from here. Looking forward to seeing how things lead up to the spaceship explosion, and seeing how we go forward to the SHIELD versus new Hydra / old Hydra kind of battle and everything, and how it all goes down. But yeah, that was Marvel's Agents of SHIELD. So thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you guys enjoyed it, then salt and burn that like button. Comment on what you thought of the episode and what you think is coming up next time on Agents of SHIELD. Again, the full length reaction will be available on Patreon, so you can go check that out over there. And yeah, that is it. So I will see you guys next time. We'll be right back.